Recording right here. Hey guys, welcome back to the DEMCAD show. I'm here with Robert O'Hara. He is a news editor at voiceformen.com, and he's a part of a movement that centers around fighting for men's rights. And I'm glad to have you here. Welcome.
Thanks for having me, Rachel. I really appreciate you having me on your show.
Oh yeah, yeah, definitely. We talked before, and I sort of wanted to dip into a phenomenon that I've been seeing over the years. When I was younger, I noticed that for some weird reason, whether it be a commercial, a TV commercial, a radio commercial, whether it be a sitcom, or even the news media, I always noticed that men were always projected, always portrayed as some bubbling idiot. Like, for example, the fathers on the sitcoms were always morons, and the women always had the right answers. And for me, I always viewed that as sort of a marketing ploy because they knew that women were the ones who consumed the most, who spent the most, and right. Therefore they were sort of tailoring their shows and their commercials towards appealing to those women, their ego.
You know, as you bring up an interesting point, the most powerful, well, probably the biggest factor, maybe the biggest factor, is the fact that women consume most stuff.
Yeah,
they're the ones who go out and buy things. So naturally, the media, entertainment media, is going to do what it feels it can do to make women feel better about themselves. Unfortunately, they've used the formula where we gotta, you know, women self-identify as a group much more than men do. So unfortunately, all too often they use the formula of let's go ahead and make dad or the husband look like a complete idiot, and that will make women feel superior. Therefore, they want to buy more stuff on the show, stuff that is advertised on our show or news program or whatever. But there's also some other sinister, more sinister factors afoot. If you look what's happened in our lifetimes, I was born in 1971. If you look what's happened, you know, in the past 40 some odd years, you'll see that men, especially fathers, have had their basic human rights whittled away by the family courts. And it's hard to do that if you see fathers or men as human beings. So what's happened is in academia, and that's where television show writers come from. They come from colleges. You know, people go to school to before they write television shows or get into the news service. In academia, we've seen this incredible ideological movement called feminism take control. And their stated aim, the second wave feminism's stated aim, was to destroy the family. And how you do that is you go after the man. You go after... And the reason this is, and Erin Pizzi said this really well, she's one of our contributors, and she's a longtime men's rights activist who single-handedly started the domestic violence abuse shelter in the UK back when I was born. She put it best. She said that if you want to destroy the family, if the state wants to take control of the family, and feminism is a statist ideology, there's no doubt about this, what you have to do is you have to go after the man, because if you got a man living with his wife or a man, whether he's married or not, living with the mother of his children and his children all under the same roof, at the end of the day, that man's loyalty is going to go towards his family and not the state or anybody else. Take that guy out of there, completely different picture. You have a set of dependent people, and that's what feminists like. They don't like a man being around. They want to see women and children living together dependent off the state. And that's kind of the formula I use to explain to see what's happening when you see men being demonized in the media so much. But it's taken on a life of its own. I mean, it's entertainment to hear about a man getting his penis cut off. It's entertainment to see men being portrayed as, at best, complete buffoons who can't do anything right. And most oftentimes is evil...
Predators.
I mean, look at CSI. It's like... It's all male perpetrators always on these shows. You know, Special Victims Unit, Law and Order Special Victims Unit and CSI. It's always a male perpetrator. It's always the damsel in distress, you know, running away from the bad man. Men really are demonized in the media today. It's really awful. There's a dehumanizing factor, and there's motivations behind that.
Why can't people see the obvious? Why can't people see how propaganda is used to dehumanize certain groups of people to achieve a greater goal? Why can't people see that? You saw that in the 1930s.
Sure.
Against the Jews. Mm-hmm. You've seen that, of course, with slavery. They basically said that black people weren't entirely people. They were three-fifths of a human being. People can't really seem to see the obvious. And when I look at feminism, I call it pseudo-feminism because a lot of their ideology is not really consistent within itself. They claim they want equality, but in reality, there's not really real equality there.
Yeah.
It's just basically equality under certain circumstances, under certain conditions. And if that's the case, it's not really true equality. The way I see it is that feminism was always used as a tool by the powers that be to create a division and create a situation that made it easier for them to actually control people.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of people who theorize that. There's a lot of people who believe that. And as I said before, feminism is a statist ideology. It was, and I had a hard time accepting this for a while, but I finally came to grips with it. Feminism really has its, second wave feminism at least, has its roots in Marxism. It is about the state. It's about state control. And with any kind of movement to get to your question, why don't people see the obvious? With any kind of movement that seeks to take away basic human rights for one group in order to control everybody, not just men but women as well, we've become a society that's been convinced that, you know, men are the cause of all these problems that we're facing, that, you know, men are the cause of every problem. This whole thing with feminism, this patriarchy theory, which is the cornerstone of feminism, is something that really, and it starts in our schools. Students are taught patriarchy theory, whether they know it or not, starting in grade school. And it goes on through college, and it's appealing. There's a flaw in human nature. There's a need, and everybody to some extent or another is guilty of this, men too, and everybody's individuals. There's this need to blame someone else for your own problems. And feminism, like Marxism, takes advantage of this. This is where you get like the class warfare scheme in Marxism, and this is where you get the gender warfare scheme in feminism. It's the exact same thing. And using this quirk in human nature, You can get people to do anything.
Absolutely.
You can get, as we saw in Nazi Germany in the 30s, you can get people to kill 6 million other people, as long as they are called other people, the other.
But it's never just one group of people.
Yeah.
And ultimately, everybody is the target. But people don't
It's really about, so as the, then as is now, Hitler used this to control the population. He used anti-Semitism. He himself, believe it or not, was not a man consumed of hate for Jewish people. He was a cynical man who used this basic need that people had to blame someone else or to have some construct in their mind of the other. It's a human quirk. It's part of the way our psyches work. He used this in a cynical fashion to bring the entire population of Germany under control. And it worked brilliantly. And nowadays, we have this thing called feminism. And it works brilliantly. It has worked brilliantly. Until now, we're starting to see some cracks in the armor.
Well, why is that?
The efforts of a lot of people.
Well, why is that? I know I have my theories, but I want you to explain why you think that is. Because we have a whole educational system that brainwashes people to think a certain way in terms of men's rights. Mm-hmm.
Now, why I think that it's changing?
Why are things changing? Is it because of the internet? Because there's just more information out there?
The internet is a huge part of it. And for a very long time, and people have always, there have always been groups and individuals that have seen feminism for what it truly is. Yeah. They've always been out there. And they've always been writing it. Since the 70s, and I brought up Aaron Pizzi. perfect example. She saw it from the very beginning, and she's been operating for quite some time now. And you know, there have been groups here in the U.S. like the National Coalition for Men and other groups that are men's rights. The men's rights movement is not new. It's been around for a while. But what's happened lately is the internet is probably the biggest factor. We no longer have to rely on a very expensive and very cumbersome news media infrastructure to get our news or to for them to analyze for us. The internet, this really had, without the men's rights movement, it would not be what it is today had the internet not happened. And, yeah, that's probably the biggest factor. People are able to share information and ideas and organize in ways that they were never able to do before. And men as a group, whether they call themselves men's rights activists or not, and there's, you know, this thing called the manosphere or the men's movement, which is bigger than just men's rights people, men, I think, because of the internet, have been able to self-identify in a way they've never been able to before. They've been able to ask questions they've never been able to. They've been able to talk with each other and explore ideas in ways they've never been able to before, in ways they really haven't been allowed to. And women, of course, have had this ability for since long before the internet. The reasons why men haven't, I think, is because... traditionally, men were had serious responsibilities they had to live up to, and been you know a man who was a complainer was not a man. There was this guy, Tom Golden, when I first started getting into men's rights work, a gentleman by the name of Tom Golden, who's a contributor to ADFM and a very dedicated men's rights activist. I called him up. I was looking for ways to get involved, and his name came up, and somebody gave me his phone number, and we talked briefly. My first time getting this, he said, "Bob, have you ever noticed why men don't complain about these things and why why things these things aren't talked to?" And I was like, "Well, gee, we're not really given an outlet for it. We're, you know, there's no like men's rights newspaper or anything like that." This was 4 years ago, and he said, "No, that's not right." He said, "Because when a man complains as a man, that man is a loser, and that is older than feminism." It's older than anything else. It's something. It's just. It's about a man's place as the expendable worker drone that our society depends on so much. Look around you. Everything around you has been built by through the sacrifice and hard work of men. And men really, in many ways, society's views men, and in many ways, women see men as utilities. And this is one of the things that has held men back from identifying as a group amongst themselves, and also speaking about problems they have. But that's changing now because it's come to critical mass now. There's so men are at a disadvantage in so many ways. You just can't ignore.
Oh yeah, I mean, I wanted to mention like one thing that's really causing things to change is the fact that you can't ignore what's happening to your friends. You see your friends get a divorce. And, and especially the guys who used to preach to you that, oh, you know, marriage is great and this is that and you should do this. And, you know, you see these guys getting a divorce and it's absolute hell. I mean, first you see these guys lose everything financially. I mean, everything from money to houses to actual tools is physically losing just about everything they have, not being able to have access to their kids, ending up in living in some crappy apartment because they don't really have their resources anymore because they lost it in the divorce. They got to fight just to see their kids. Some of these women actually take their kids and leave the state. And these guys try to follow their kids, these women, across the country and actually lose their jobs. They lose everything they built. It's hard to really ignore that now. Before, it used to be, oh, well, you know, that's just one guy. He's a loser, whatever. He didn't do it right. But now it's like, okay, this is my brother. This is my friend. It's happening everywhere.
Yeah, the divorce. I was born in 1971. That was the year. It was a very important year in the history of this country. That was the year that the percentage of marriages that failed after 10 years went to 50% and above, and it's been hovering around there ever since. And we've seen in family courts in the past 35 years a real increase in the way that men can just in the number of ways that men can just get completely screwed. And when I say screwed,
we're
just talking about this. We're talking about basic human rights here. Your right to your property. Your right to to parent your children. Your right to freedom. What is this business that you get married to somebody, you have kids, and all of a sudden they make a unilateral decision to end the marriage? Okay, whatever. But they get to take your kids and turn you into wage slave, and your relationship with your children is entirely dependent on that person's goodwill. This is crazy. And the nightmare, you've seen this, I've seen it. The average man, by the time he's 30, even if he hasn't gotten married, knows, has several close friends and family male family members who have been destroyed, who have had their lives as they knew it destroyed by this family court system, by someone makes a unilateral decision. Now, let's make a mistake, no fault of force, and that was the big starting point of this.
Oh, yeah. That basically, just so people know, from my understanding, it basically meant no matter if your wife just cheated on you and left, screwed you over any other way imaginable, there was no fault in these divorces, which meant that she could still get access to a lot of your funds, a lot of your savings. It was literally no default.
It used to be where, like, if you wanted a divorce, okay.
Yeah.
But if you wanted the kids, if you wanted alimony, you had to show fault.
Yeah.
You had to say, this person violated the terms of this agreement. And if you just wanted out because you weren't happy, well, fine, that's okay. But you weren't going to get the house. You weren't going to get the kids. You weren't going to get half of everything this guy's ever – and here's a good divorce. Right nowadays, this is a good divorce. Somebody makes a unilateral decision to end the marriage. Then usually the person who always the person who was the one who was the primary breadwinner, which is defined as basically the person who makes more money, whatever the heck, you know, that means. They lose half of everything they've ever earned in their entire life, oftentimes before the marriage. And then if there's children involved, the kids go to the person that made the least money, usually the women. Because women do not choose men as mates who make less money than they do. Let's be honest, that's hypergamy is real.
There are stats behind that.
Yeah, right. And so you lose – in a divorce, you lose half of everything you ever worked for in your entire life. You lose your kids, and you have to pay child support. That's that you do not get to negotiate the amount paid, and it's based on your imputed income, meaning that it doesn't matter if you're only making 40 grand a year now. If you were making 100 grand 2 years ago, they're going to base your payments based on what you're making at your highest point, which is absolutely ridiculous. That's a good divorce. A bad divorce is you a false allegation is leveled at you, which happens all the time. You're thrown.
Oh, she hit the kids. She hit the kids.
You never see your kids, and then you have to pay an outrageous amount of alimony.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, we hear stories we get every day in our email boxes at ABFM between Paul and I and Dean. We get guys just writing with appalling stories. It's just like amazing what these guys are going through. And no one pays attention. The general media does not pay attention to what is going on here.
How common is it for some of these guys to deal with false allegations of domestic violence or child abuse as a tactic in divorce?
Here's the thing. The Violence Against Women Act, which was passed in 1994, signed into law by Bill Clinton, and there have been other legislation before that kind of did the same type of thing. But basically, the whole thing behind it, and it's feminism behind this whole thing. This idea that men are perpetrators and only women are victims, and that all intimate relations between men and women is all about men exerting power over women using violence and other means. It's a hate-filled idea. And what has happened is, and this was the end game of VAVA, was to take away due process from any man accused of domestic violence, and also to expand the definition of domestic violence. So what happens is, in many states right now, if a woman wants to eject a man from her life and her children's life for whatever reason, the only thing she has to do is make a phone call to the police and say, "I feel threatened." Police come to the house. They don't do an investigation. they'll arrest the guy, they'll throw him in jail. An ex parte restraining order is in place, so the guy can't go home. He can't see his kids. He doesn't have access to his basic papers, his social security documents, his work documents, his tax documents. Of course, when you're married, your wife has
power of attorney.
Power of attorney, and you know that's like that right there. That's huge. I mean, if you're married to a woman who's a high conflict person, an abusive woman who's a high conflict personality, she can easily use that as a tool to completely destroy you. And this happens. People say, "Oh, why would anybody want to do that? Oh, that's terrible. Why would you say that woman would do that?" I'm like, "Hey, listen, the women have just as much of a propensity to be psychopathic as men do. Why? I mean, seriously, what?" What do you think? I mean, what kind of rosy ideas do you have about women? Women are human beings just like men. Of course, there's gonna when you expand the definition of domestic violence and sexual assault as they have, it's going to invite false accusations. When you get rid of due process, it's going to invite false allegations. It's just going to. And look at the benefits involved. If you're a woman who wants to, you will get everything. You will get the children. You will get all the money. You will never have to deal with this guy again. And oftentimes, it's over just something, you know, simply she doesn't feel satisfied anymore. She just doesn't want this guy in her life anymore. And it's that simple. And I see this, I've seen this happen dozens of times in my life, where a guy's completely innocent, and you know, all of a sudden he comes home to an empty house. The wife's gone. She alleges that he abused the children. He never sees his kids again, and his life is destroyed. I'm talking good guys here, guys who and they never had a chance to prove their innocence because there's no due process for men who are accused of domestic violence and other things like especially like child abuse or anything like that. You're done. And that's what you're entering into when you enter into a relationship with a woman. You live under the same roof with a woman. It's all the same rules apply, even if you're not married. And oftentimes to couples who are simply dating, it's terrible with what's happened with the Violence Against Women Act. It's the worst piece of legislation we've had. It violates so many of our basic constitutional principles. But we all like it because, you know, women are in danger all the time and we have to protect them at the expense of everything else, including basic fundamental human rights. And this is wrong. This is very wrong-headed of our society. And only now – well, I want to say only now. People have been complaining about this ever since VAWA was written into law. But the damage that's been done has gotten to the point where it's a critical mass. You just cannot ignore it anymore. But the press – and feminists and government is they know what's wrong with it. They know the true nature of domestic violence that is not gender specific. But there's so much money involved and so much political power involved that they just do not want it to be challenged. They don't want this ideology to be challenged. They don't want the law to be challenged. But it's going to have to change at some point or another. It's going to have to. This is not sustainable the way things are.
Well, yeah, because otherwise, why would a guy want to get married if he has to endure with all these risks?
No. You're stupid if you do that. You really are. And you have arguments with guys, especially guys who are the gamer, the PUA gamer types. You know, like, well, you know, if you have game, then your wife would never falsely accuse you or anything. No. Yeah, you hear that, and then also, and actually, my brother, I was talking about this. My brother said, Bob, you know. And he's happily married to a marvelous woman. She's wonderful. I love my sister-in-law. They have two great kids together. But like a lot of married guys, a lot of men, unfortunately, he's like, you know, Bob, all those guys that go through all that nasty stuff in divorce court, they're just stupid. They're just – I mean, they're not like me. I'm smart. So that's never going to happen to me. But all those other guys, they're just stupid. I was like, wait a minute. They're not stupid. They're human beings. They're just like you. They just happen to be – the stupid thing they did was they got married, number one. And what happens is that you marry the wrong person, this is easy to do. I mean, you know,
especially if you get married young.
You get married young, people change. People are psychopaths. People are exploitative. And also, people buy into this whole like you know pipe dream of what I call it, a stupid pipe dream of matrimony. It's a stupid validation of manhood. You know, I got to get married to somebody soon. And then they end up just marrying the first person. Well, I mean, look what happens. You know, this person, you've given this person the power to destroy your life. What do you think is going to happen? Of course it's going to happen all the time to normal, smart, men are going to have their lives destroyed. But why? Because the laws are that way. I mean, that's what it is. And of course, we have these quirks in human nature that both men and women have. And, you know, the laws, especially domestic violence laws and child custody laws and child support laws, alimony laws, kind of speak towards they appeal towards the darker quirks of female human nature. This is a touchy subject, but it's one worth exploring.
Yeah, go into it.
Men have their own quirks. Women have their own quirks, too.
Let's talk about both of them.
I'm sorry, say again?
Yeah, let's talk about both of them. I want to hear this.
Yeah, sure. Let's talk about men's quirks first, just to be fair. What the heck? You know, men sexually have the desire to inseminate as many women as possible, and, you know, this and that.
We're visual. We're visual. We don't need that.
Their little sexual things, you know. But here's the women have their sexual things. But the difference is that men's sexuality is demonized. Women's sexuality is idealized.
Hmm.
But they're both just as base. We're talking about sex here, for Christ's sake. But this is one of those things. And when it comes to family law and especially family law with you know, divorce law, hypergamy is a factor in the female psyche that people don't like talking about. But here's the deal with that. Women tend to look for men. When women look for mates, they want someone who can provide them with security and status. And this is just part of human nature. It is what it is.
Yeah.
It's not going to change. It's because women are human beings. You have to grant them their humanity. But this can be used in such a way to where, like, if a woman is married to a guy and she feels she can make this into a better deal by simply turning this guy into a sperm donor turned ATM machine and take his money and essentially be not married to this guy and still be taken care of by him as if they still were married via alimony and child support and the unfair division of marital assets. Why would she not get a divorce? Why would she not? I mean, it's insane. It's just if you have no penalties for this, for exiting this business contract, which is what marriage is, I mean, it's no wonder the divorce rate so high. It's in about 70% of all divorces are initiated by women. And the main reason cited for divorce overwhelmingly is not abuse or alcoholism or any others, or abandonment, anything else like that. It's, quote, lack of satisfaction. Well, what's happening is for women, and this is kind of a, you know, we say that men are more scared of a commitment and men are not commitment oriented. I don't think that's true. I think for women, and this is hard for a lot of people to swallow, but it's kind of true. And I think that the data proves this is that women will end a marriage if they feel they can get a better deal. and they you see this happening all the time.
Well, we often hear that, you know, men are only as loyal as their best, as their options, and they want to find the prettiest women, and that's generally men want to. I find that men want to find a good-looking woman who has a good personality and has basically got their back. That's basically what men are.
Someone's got their back. Someone that's going to be on their team.
Yeah.
But that, unfortunately.
But that's not how we're sort of portrayed as, you know. We're going to be cheating on every woman we're with. And
yeah, as if women never do those. Just likely to cheat as men are. It's like this whole, like, infidelity thing. And again, this is part of the whole demonization of male sexuality. Again, it's used to justify all kinds of abuses. It's really the demonization of male sexuality and the over-idealization of female sexuality and the over-idealization of women, I think, in general, is one of those dangerous forces in our society. I really do believe that. I think it's caused tremendous damage. We need to get women off the pedestal. They're human beings just like us. They deserve to be treated equally, and not, they deserve to not be idealized.
Yeah.
But you know, in many ways, we over idealize women. We treat and infantilizing women. We've always done this to women for practical reasons. But feminism, instead of giving equality, has taken this infantilization and taken it up to a whole new level. It's amazing you see, feminists are very hypocritical when it comes to this. And they, these people that, that most people kind of dismiss as just being these crazy wackos that, you know, they're just crazy feminists, whatever. I'm like, I try to point out to people, like, these people are in control of our family judicial law system. They're in control of our education system. They have the media in their back pocket. They control the
How do we change that? That's something I've been wondering about, because schools are so dominated by women.
Yeah.
I mean, not just the teachers. I'm not saying they're all out to get anybody, but, you know, they're overwhelmingly female, especially when you look at the primary schools.
Yep.
They're dominated by women. The administration is dominated by women. Men, they don't even have a voice in the schools. So how can we have any type of meaningful change if we can't even have any type of influence in schools? Is this a situation where men don't have an interest in educating kids, working with kids, or is this a situation where men are often target when they try to work with kids?
To answer your question in two parts, first part, let's talk about the education system itself. Sure, the teaching profession has always been more of a female thing than a male thing, but it wasn't always the way that it is now, where you never, in primary schools, you rarely see male teachers.
Rarely.
But yeah, it's rare. Before the 1980s, it wasn't uncommon at all to have a male preschool. I had a male preschool teacher, Mr. Murphy. He was great. We loved him. He's a lot of fun, you know. There's a physicality involved there. He roughhoused the kids a lot, which all the boys loved a lot. When I was going to grade school, well, we had male teachers. But now, if you go to a primary school, if you go to a grade school, there's no male teachers. None. It's in, or very few. And then if you're on a preschool level, there is virtually no male teachers. There's not. You cannot. And the reason this is, again, it's because men have been the target of a terrible smear campaign. And that's by, I think truly that's by design. They want to, it's done things. The damage that's done because of this is immense. This is the reason why we put boys on Ritalin nowadays. We are giving our boys psychoactive drugs. It's speed. It's amphetamine. It's like cocaine. It's a drug. And what these things do is they basically make boys act more the way female teachers want them to act. Why? Because female teachers, well, they're females. They don't relate to students the way they relate to their female students. You need to have male teachers in that environment, or else the boys aren't going to learn.
Well, I mean, why can't they figure that out? Or is this done intentionally? Because it seems pretty obvious to me. You have boys falling behind in a lot of school districts, and you don't have a lot of guys there to be that male role model. And then you have a bigger problem where a lot of these kids, especially in urban areas, they don't even have fathers.
Yeah. But the thing is people are figuring out what this problem is. People are figuring out that there is a problem. But then what happens? Who do we blame? Well, we blame the men. We blame the fathers who never didn't have the same amount of control as whether or not to become a parent in the first place, who had their kids taken away from in family court. But have always been a scapegoat. It's just this unfortunate thing. Men are being scapegoated for this entire mess we have in our education system, now in large part. But this is changing. I really think that people are starting to pay attention to this now. We're starting to hear more and more. But the solution is, and here's the thing, the solution is we have to recognize that our entire school system has been taken over. Our entire public education system has been taken over by a bunch of radical gender ideologues. Our school system has become feminized in a way. When I say feminized, I mean feminism, not necessarily female. It's been enveloped by this ideology. And every day, if you talk to male students every day, I have nephews that are entering into college age, and I talk to other kids who are younger. They tell you horror stories about how they're treated in class, in school. I mean, you hear these horror stories every day where you have these 7-year-old boys suspended for playing cowboys and Indians, or, you know, or telling their teacher that they think they're cute, normal boy behavior. And it's terrible that boys are being demonized like this. And people, I think, are figuring this out now. But the damage is so far along now. And when you bring this ideology into the factor, these ideologues, they don't give up control easily. They will fight tooth and nail to maintain their control over the ideas that are being taught to students and the ideology that runs the school system. They're not going to give up power easily. It's just unfortunate fact that sometimes you have to wait for people to die off before you can solve a systemic problem. But people are starting to realize this. But the damage that's been done has been immense. I mean, we've had two generations of male students who I think have been wasted. It's amazing the damage that's been done.
Yeah, it's always more time consuming, always more difficult to repair the damage than to actually implement policies that create a lot of damage. So that's something that we have to keep in mind as well. So what other issues regarding men's rights? Because I definitely wanted to talk about education. I'm glad you sort of touched upon that subject. I'm sure there's some issues that you also want to touch on as well. Mm-hmm.
Other issues of men's rights are men's health. If treatment in our criminal courts, huge thing.
Now that really interests me because, as a lot of you guys know, I have a BA in criminal justice, so I've always had an interest in the criminal justice system. So please sort of expand upon that. Because when I think of that, I think of how female teachers oftentimes are, when they're accused or when they get caught having sex with their students, it's like, oh, well, we'll give you like probation or a slap on a wrist. But if it's a guy, I mean, you're looking at
jail for 10 years.
Oh, you're looking like 15 years in prison, okay? And, you know, committing the exact same act or whatever. Anything is worse. Whenever a man does something, it's worse.
Have you ever heard of Stefan Molyneux, Freedom Man Radio? He did a great, great video on this. I'll send you a link. Maybe you can put it in the description box about this, about the truth of criminality. There's a lot of people in the men's rights movement and a lot of MGTOWs have done fantastic videos on the issue of female criminality and how it's just as bad as male criminality. It's different because men and women are different, but it's just as bad. But there's this thing about women in our culture. We give them nothing but excuses for their bad behavior.
And they're always the victim. They're the flower. There's
some excuse, like if some woman is having sexual relations with a male of an inappropriate age, she's said to have been seduced by this kid, or she had some other issues, or she'd been going through some bad emotional problems, or she had some sort of drug problem that led her to this. But it's like, no, hold on a second. If you're a 38-year-old woman and you're having sex with a 13-year-old kid, you're a child molester. That's what you are. But people don't see it that way. And it comes down, again, unfortunately, to the demonization of male sexuality. You know, we hear these things where, like, oh, 13-year-old boy, of course, you know, he's been thinking about it all the time. He's lucky, you know. Well, guess what? 13-year-old girls, they have sexual fantasies about adult males in their life. But that doesn't make it okay for said adult males to have sex with them. That's still just – it's abhorrent. Everybody knows that. A 13-year-old kid cannot consent to have sex with an adult.
They're not at a place where mentally they understand the consequences and the implications of what they're doing.
They're not at the same level as an adult. They're not adults. They don't. It's not an equal relationship. But unfortunately, female pedophiles take advantage of this over-idealization of their sexual nature, and it's terrible. God, I mean, you hear these horror stories. These 13-year-old boys, they're being molested by these 40-year-old women, and when their families seek justice, these victims, these male victims of child molestation, they're re-victimized. Like, hey, what's wrong with you, kid? God, seriously, really? You know, of course, you know, hey, your penis got hard, so you consented, right? And it's like, wait a minute, I've talked with guys who are the victims of statutory rape. You know, when they were like 13, 14 years old, from their teachers, other people, friends of parents. And the effects, the damage is just as bad as if it's done to a girl. they always say the same thing. It's like my childhood was taken away from me. I couldn't really process normal emotions when it came to intimacy for a very long time after that until I finally found help. And oftentimes men can't find help for this, who are the victims of statutory rape. It's really terrible that we feel this way about this particular subject. And again, back to how we treat men and women differently in criminal cases, whenever we talk about it, especially when it comes to sexuality, women are given excuses, they're given a pass, they're not held to the same standard of accountability. It's hard to even get a woman arrested for such a thing. It's hard to get a woman arrested for domestic violence. For men, it's mandatory. It's mandatory. Even if the guy calls the police and says, hey, my wife just assaulted me, I need a cop right away, cops are going to come there, they're going to arrest him, even though he's the victim. So just at the arrest level, you have this problem. And then it comes to the prosecution level. It's much more likely that a man's going to get prosecuted for the same crime that a woman is. Okay, and then you get to the actual conviction level. Men are far more likely to get convicted for the same crime that a woman is. And then you have the sentencing level. You have where men are sentenced to 40% longer prison terms than women are all other things adjusted. All other things adjusted. And even then, when they're convicted, women are far more likely to get a favorable parole hearing. They're far more likely to get to have their cases reheard, retried, and then have the conviction overturned. At every single stage of the game, men are held to a much higher level of accountability and responsibility, and women are not. We truly, when it comes to crime, women are truly treated as children. And they're even more so treated as children, treated more as children than are male children treated who commit crimes.
Oh, yeah.
It's just, I mean,
especially if it's a really serious one. You're an adult.
I remember, there was a case just in Canada a little while ago, an article I wrote, where these guys were – some naked pictures of girls are being circulated around cell phones in some high school somewhere. And they rounded up all the boys who were involved. They expelled them. They're on criminal charges, whatnot. But what was going on is these girls were taking pictures of themselves – and distributing them themselves. Why were the girls not arrested for manufacturing pornography and distributing pornography? Why not? They're the ones who were actually taking pictures of themselves. These guys just were receiving pictures going, oh, wow, cool, look at this. And they get thrown in, and all of a sudden now they're facing charges as an adult for child pornography. This is insanity. This is insanity. It's just crazy. And that's just one example. And I can think of dozens. So,
yeah, absolutely. Had a
whole show about that.
Well, yeah, I want to hear a couple more.
There was, of course, there's a whole, there was one case in Britain about, this is a real horrific case, this about 4 years ago. Really upset a lot of people. I was too upset to even write an article about it. There was an instance where there were two boys aged 9 and 7, and there was an 8-year-old girl, and the 8-year-old girl accused the boys of trying to rape her. Mm. Now, keep in mind here, these are prepubescent boys. These are little boys, okay? The notion that a 6-year-old boy or a 7-year-old boy would be even capable of raping anybody is absurd. They're not sexual beings yet. They're not, I mean, for that to happen would be like, the kid would have to be a total freak of nature for this to happen. But they're accused of attempted rape, went to trial. During the course of the trial, the girl who accused the boys of attempted rape told the people who were questioning her that she lied about what had happened, that she had essentially initiated interaction in which was basically like boys and girls playing nurses and doctors. You know, I'll show me yours if you show me mine. I'll show you mine if you show me yours. You know, this is something, this is a game that children have played since human beings have been wearing clothes. Everyone has done this before. She initiated this, and she was scared because like an adult had seen her go back to the shed or wherever this incident occurred. And she was scared that when her mother asked her about this, it was then that she lied about it. Said, oh, the boys tried to do something naughty to me. And she said that she did this because she was scared of the negative consequences. She said, and I'm going to quote, she said, I didn't think I was going to get any sweets. So she lied. And children lie about that kind of thing all the time because it's naughty. That's why boys and girls play this game, because it's naughty. Okay. Of course, no one wants to get caught, showing their thingies to someone of the opposite sex when you're that age. So that's what happened. Well, what happened was the judge heard this, and the judge was thinking about dismissing the case, and the prosecuting attorney actually said, listen, she may have said what she said, but the charges were, quote, so serious that we have to go on with this case.
That's
so they did go on with the case, and the jury ended up convicting these two boys.
How?
Of attempted rape.
How?
Apparently, because the charges were, quote, so serious.
But didn't they know that the girl admitted that she was lying?
The prosecution brought up this idea that, you know, the girl felt intimidated because, like, during the process of the cross-examination, that, you know, it was so overwhelming for her that you couldn't really believe what she said. Well, I mean, this is absurd because
they don't have a reasonable doubt standard there.
Well, no, they do. It works very much the same way as our criminal justice system does. Here's the problem. We're talking about two defendants who were boys. That's what the problem was. This prosecutor actually said, because this was the allegations were, quote, so serious, we have to go on with the trial, even though there's no evidence of this, and the alleged victim confessed that she lied. It was the seriousness of the allegation that got these boys convicted. Now, this would never happen if the sexes were changed. It would be inconceivable this would happen. And you would think it would be inconceivable that it even happened in this case, but in fact, it did. Crazy, crazy, crazy double standards of accountability and responsibility, and no rights. When if you're male and you're accused of, no matter what age, you're accused of any kind of sexual crime, you don't have due process. We have rape shield laws in this country where in many cases, you don't have the right to face your accuser. It's a basic fundamental principle of criminal justice that if someone accuses you of something, that person names themselves and your counsel gets to cross-examine them in a court of law. Well, with these rape shield laws, you can't question if it comes down to your word versus her word. You can't question, or you can't even bring up in the court an instance where she was actually proven to have falsely accused another man of the same crime. Because that's considered going into her sexual past, which is part of the rape shield laws.
But, I mean, obviously that violates the Bill of Rights.
Of course it does.
Because you're supposed to be... Yeah.
There are so many instances like that. When it comes to gender, when it comes to males who have the criminal justice system coming down, bearing down on them, you just don't have any rights. If you're male and you've been accused of any kind of wrongdoing by a female, and this is something that's been happens, something that feminists have done. If you're male and you've been accused by any wrongdoing by a female, you have no due process rights. Why? Because men are all evil, and as such, and there's this huge problem with rape. There's a rapist behind every tree, and every man is a potential rapist, and 1 in 4, 1 in 3 women are being raped, and rape is happening all the time. So therefore, let's just do away with due process for men. That's the philosophy behind it.
And they use the same thing with terrorism. You know, it's a terrorism.
Yes,
the absolutely. Terrorists around every corner or something like that. Therefore, you have to surrender your Fourth Amendment rights.
Therefore, the NSA is listening to what we're talking about right now.
Yes, they have to do
it. Therefore, it's okay for a drone somewhere, even I don't care where, whether it's on the other side of the world, it's okay for a drone to target an individual American citizen and drop a bomb right on their head without any trial whatsoever. It's the exact same thing. If you create fear, it's fear. If you create fear, if you target a group and make society fearful of that group, you can do just about anything. And there's another thing, and last time I talked with you, we talked about this idea of the best interest of the children.
Oh, yeah.
And women, it's the same way with women. If you can convince people that women are in some kind of imminent danger all the time, therefore we have to do something, even when they're not, you can strip away the rights of men everywhere. And that's what's happened with this feminism thing. And also with the children thing where, you know, Hitler himself once said that if the state can convince the people that it has the children's best interests at heart, the people will go through any – unquestionably, people without question will submit themselves to any injustice. And it's true. It's absolutely true. It's a quirk of human nature. But this happens – if people understood just how – if men, most men understood just how fucked up – pardon my language, I'm sorry – just how messed up our criminal justice system was in this regard and how they didn't they don't have the same rights as other human beings because they've been dehumanized in this respect, they just wouldn't believe it. I mean, most men don't believe just how bad this is. But it really is bad, and most men don't believe until it's too late, until they're accused of something, or they risk losing their kids in divorce court if falsely accused of domestic violence or sexual assault. It's just terrible.
Well, that's just how everything works. Most people aren't interested in anything until it directly affects them. No matter how big the problem becomes, you know, it's not a big deal. The economic situation isn't a big deal because I still have a job. You know, I still have a certain amount of resources, but of course, when I lose my job and things are unraveling and it's affecting me, then all of a sudden,
it becomes a big deal.
Yeah, I mean that's how it works with everything. So it's very unfortunate. What can we do about the criminal justice system? A lot of people say that voting is pretty much the key to turning things around.
It's not. It's more than voting. That we need to, and this is happening now. We need to start. People need to start engaging in activism, and there are some marvelous groups out there that are changed. They're lobbying legislatures and acting through the courts, which I think is probably the most effective way to do this. There's Stop Abuse in Violent Environments that does a lot of work on Capitol Hill. I used to work with them. They lobby heavily. Some people in the men's rights movement have questioned the effectiveness of lobbying. I think there's still a place for it, but it's proven over the years to be not as effective as other things. But I think the biggest thing is just actual legal actions through the courts. If you're a man, you've been falsely accused, you should be – I think men need to start doing this. They need to start suing the crap out of their accusers. If you can prove that you've been falsely, you need to sue them. And what's happening in our school systems now, we have this thing in higher education called the Dear Colleague Letter, where you only need a 50.001% possibility that the guy might be guilty to have him expelled from school and have a permanent mar on his record. And of course, you know, they're working outside of the criminal justice system there. It's like the schools have taken on the role of criminal prosecutions now, which is completely wrong. Now we're starting to see students, one kid at the University of Delaware is suing the University of Delaware for having been kicked off campus, you know, even though he was, they found out that the person who accused him was lying and he was able to get back into school. He was not able to be on campus for 90 days, and it affected his
academic career, about that.
Of course, so now he's suing them. So like the use of lawsuits to the courts, I think, is a very important thing. It's going to make people wake up. It's going to cost money to people who accuse. It's going to cost police departments and prosecutors and schools. Once you start making it to where it costs people money to do these really discriminatory things, then we're going to start seeing some changes. That's, I think it's an important avenue. And I'm optimistic about it.
Hit them in the pocketbook.
Yeah, sure. And there's another wonderful organization called FIRE, the Foundation for Individual Rights and Education. It's really taken on the whole campus sexual assault hysteria thing. They're a marvelous organization. They've done wonderful work. So I think that basic, like, talking about it, speaking out about it, and organizing just to make people aware, because that's the biggest thing. Most people just are not aware how bad this is. And actually it'll take getting men who've been falsely accused to take strong legal action. Yeah, that's a big thing. And that men have been discouraged from doing that in the past because, like, a lot of men who've been falsely accused, they sort of think, oh, my – it destroys them. It crushes them. It crushes their soul when it really does something to destroy their entire life. And a lot of times they just want to get on with it. And oftentimes whenever they try to seek recompense, they've been re-demonized, re-victimized. Oh, this is just proof that you were guilty all along, that you want to re-victimize your victim and all this. And that's changing now. More and more men are starting to actually take legal action against their false accusers. So I think that's, to answer your question, I think that's the way that it could change.
Yeah, and I hope it does, because there's a lot of guys get into a lot of trouble and they haven't really did anything. I keep thinking about the Duke LaCrosse situation.
Yeah, and that's that's rare. It happens all the time. It happens all the time. And no man is safe from a false rape accusation. It can happen to any man at any time for whatever reason. It can happen, the accusation can be leveled at you from somebody you don't even know, never met before. You still get thrown in jail, still have your life destroyed. It can be loaded at you from a coworker, family member, your wife, anybody. Once that happens, you are at this huge disadvantage. Even if you're found innocent, as in the case with the Duke LaCrosse scandal, your life is over. Your life's destroyed. Your reputation's gone. You've lost your job. If you had a family, if you're married, your wife probably left you. It's just terrible what happens. And here's another thing. There's some basic things we can do to solve this. First of all, this whole business of the double standard of anonymity has to go. If the press is not going to release the name of someone who accused someone else of sexual assault, the person who's accused should have their name remain suppressed as well. And we need to get rid of these rape shield laws. And once someone is found to have given a false accusation deliberately, we need to start throwing those people in jail.
Absolutely.
If we did those four things, so much of this problem would go away.
Well, I like the money aspect of things, actually suing these people, but throwing people in jail. It's the same thing I said about Wall Street and the criminals on Wall Street. People who steal and people who engage in fraud in corporations and even in government or whatever. Until people go to prison, people are going to take this seriously.
What's going on? Absolutely, yeah.
So that's going to have to be – that's one of the biggest part of it right there.
Well, it's like, you hear these stories where, like, this guy was falsely accused. He goes to jail for, in some cases, decades. And then it's found out positively that this woman lied, whether she admitted it or some new DNA evidence came up, or whether she talked about it to somebody else and then that person ratted her out, and then or whatever. I mean, look what happens with Brian Banks. You've heard of Brian Banks, haven't you?
No.
Okay, he was an up-and-coming football star in high school. Was falsely accused by his girlfriend of raping. He spent seven years in prison. He gets out. He's still on probation for a long period of time after that. He has to wear this ankle collar. His life is pretty much destroyed at this point. And this person who falsely accused him gets in touch with him on Facebook and wants to hook up and be buddy-buddy with him again. You know, he's like, whoa, what's going on here? So he arranged a meeting with this girl, but he had it recorded surreptitiously. And during this meeting, he got her to admit that she lied, got her to say that she lied and why she lied and all this. He turned it over to – and the Innocence Projects came in and took over, and he got exonerated. But this girl, she never saw any kind of – there was no criminal – the prosecutor didn't come up and say, listen, you're going to go to jail and you're going to spend every single minute in jail that this guy did. But that didn't happen. There was another girl in New York that falsely accused this guy that simply gave her a ride back home of raping her that she confessed later on. And she's actually going to spend like a year in jail, but he spent almost 10 years in jail. You see this happen over and over and over again. These cases get overturned. The women come in and confess, or they're found out otherwise. And they don't spend – if they're lucky, they spend a minimal amount of time in jail. If you sit there, if you lie about that, and you sit there on the witness stand, and you point at somebody and said, that person raped me, and then you sit there and watch as that guy is sentenced, convicted and sentenced to 20 years in prison, and you watch that person – cuffed and walk and throw my agent, and you sit and for 5 years goes by and you never said anything, you know this guy's in prison. Guess what? If you're found out, you should have to spend the exact same amount of time that guy spent in jail.
At least.
On top of your charge for perjury. You know? It's just, but we don't do this again because we do not. We would give.
But I mean, the part of the problem is that a lot of these women wouldn't even admit that they lied if that was the case, because they would be worried about going to prison.
Sure,
and it's too hard to really prove whether she was lying or not in the first place.
Right, and so, she has this incentive to conceal her dishonesty because she's afraid maybe she might get in trouble.
Well, what about these guys when they get convicted and they're exonerated? What happens when they try to apply for a job? Do they still have to say that, yeah, I was convicted?
Well, no. If you've been exonerated, supposedly your criminal record is expunged and all this. But there's so much publicity around rape cases now. The other thing that has to happen is someone – because every time you apply for a job, it's depending on what state you're in, employers really are not allowed to do this. But you're going to have – someone's going to do a Google search on you. They're going to. And it's going to be found out. You know, it's like, oh, wow. And you still have the arrest record. It costs a lot of money to expunge all these records. It costs a lot of money. There are databases floating around everywhere where if you get any kind of trouble at all, even if you were exonerated or found not guilty, it doesn't matter. You still have this record that you were arrested. And what's that look like? If this guy was arrested, sexual assault? Oh my God! Hey, forget what I.
Yeah, no. I mean, good luck trying to explain that. Oh, I was in prison for the last 7 years for sexual assault.
What's his
I was exonerated. I mean, all you hear is prison and sexual assault. I mean,
yeah, what were you in prison for? Oh, for rape. But you know, I was exonerated. Well, listen. As soon as you say the word rape, the conversation stops there in the other person's mind.
Well, I guess you gotta say I was exonerated.
Yeah, but that doesn't even.
No, I mean, you gotta say exonerated first, maybe.
Yeah. I mean, in many people's minds, it's just you're Mark Mann. Once you're accused and the law gets involved, even if the law doesn't get involved, you're Mark Mann. And this is true of sexual harassment in the workplace. Men who are accused of sexual, this happened to me. Once you're accused of sexual harassment, your career's over. Even if there's no formal, I mean, just once the whispering campaign starts, it's just you. It's a career ender, and that's bad enough too. It's bad enough as it is.
And it doesn't take much at all. I mean, sexual harassment. If you actually read those policies, it's absolutely insane. I remember when I was like 15, 16 years old, and I was working for this organization, and I was there. There was a teenage girl, and there was a couple college age students, and this one girl, for some reason, she mentioned to the supervisor that she thought that I was going to ask her for her phone number. She thought that I was going to ask her for her phone number.
And you were called in, and they had to talk to you about this and all that.
Yeah, I mean, and they go over the whole sexual harassment policy, and basically, for a lot of situations, even if you're accused, you're basically screwed.
You're screwed.
Yeah, I'm thinking about like, wow, you would have thought I grabbed someone's tits or something, or some ass, or saying that.
Did you hear about Donglegate?
No.
Okay, this is a big thing in the tech industry. The tech industry, the software industry, has been for the most part dominated by men.
Yeah.
Because men have, men and women have different values. They have different tastes in what they want to do for a living. And, oh, yes, let's admit it. Men and women have different aptitudes. In general, they have different aptitudes. Of course, there are a lot of women who are very competent computer programmers and can write software just fine. But there are more men that can do that than women. Why? Because men and women are different. Anyway, so what happens is women have started getting into the tech business. And of course, whenever that happens, feminism kind of wants to, anytime there's a situation or any area in our society, whether it be a social movement like atheism or an employment area like tech, where that's dominated by men, feminists like to say, oh, there's discrimination going on, when there's really no discrimination whatsoever. It's just the way things are. But anyway, there was an instance at a tech conference in California. This was Dongle Gate, when they had it earlier on this year, where this woman who was a marketing person for this tech firm was sitting in a row in front of and five rows down from these three guys who were having a conversation amongst themselves. And in this conversation, they used the word dongle. And they also used the word forking a repo. To her mind, she said, oh, dongle means, it's referring to male genitalia, and forking a repo means, it's a sexual thing. It means basically having sexual intercourse. I shouldn't have to be subjected to this kind of language. She took a picture, she turned around and took a picture of these guys. Again, these guys are just minding their own business. She took a picture of these guys. Then she emailed her company and said, I just felt so offended by their conversation. And two of these guys got fired. They got fired. No investigation, nothing. They just got canned. Now, let me tell you what they were talking about. Dongles are actual devices. They are actual pieces of hardware. They're like little flash drive things is what they are. And they're actual pieces of hardware. And they're called dongles. Okay? That's all. So they weren't talking about male genitalia. They were talking about dongles. They were talking about computer hardware. And when they were talking about forking a repo, they weren't talking about sex. Forking a repo basically means kind of like a plagiarism in a good way of someone's software and then altering it to make it better. So these guys were just talking shop, basically. They weren't talking about anything sexual. This woman, in her ignorance, interprets this as a sexual conversation. She feels that she should not be submitted, even though she wasn't the one, even though she was not part of the conversation, she was eavesdropping in someone else's conversation. She takes a picture of these guys, she writes something about it on her blog, and these guys lose their, two of these guys lose their job. One of these guys has a family. It's just terrible. And thank God this instance was highly publicized, and this woman was really brought out. She was really run through the ringers by a lot of people. We did a show on it. it was just, oh yeah, that was actually one of our better shows. But it was just, it goes to show you that there's this huge power that women have in the workplace that they shouldn't have. You shouldn't just be able to point somebody and say, I didn't like what he said. And then the guy gets fired.
Even if it has nothing to do with the person who's making the complaint. If you read the policies, it's just, it's all about perception. If you read the policies, Absolutely. It's not about any actual, no action. You don't actually have to do anything. It's purely perception. What they're basically saying is, okay, if you say something and it's overheard, you know, or
yeah.
Even if you're not talking to the person, if the person overhears
it's all
you,
how the person
and it's
all
yeah.
how the accuser feels.
Exactly, it's how they perceive it. If they perceive it to be sexual harassment, then that's sexual harassment.
And that's it, and you lose your job. And once you lose your job under those circumstances, kiss your career goodbye. No one's going to hire you because you're way too much of a liability for any company. That's because those things get expensive. Those sexual harassment lawsuits are just cripplingly expensive, especially for a small company, even for a big one. They don't want to have anything to do with you after that. You're done. Your career's done. It's done.
Yeah.
It's an ugly, ugly situation. But again, we have these factors. We have this incredible over-idealization for women. We have feminism, this hateful ideology, this hate movement that's taken over our the entire discourse when it comes to gender relations and, you know, when it comes to sexual harassment law. They're the ones who wrote the law where perception is enough, accusation is enough to get you fired or thrown in jail. It was feminists who did that. It's just terrible.
It's absolutely insane. So
it is insane.
All right, man. Thank you. Thank you, Robert O'Hara. I really appreciate all this information you gave us. You're the news editor, is that correct?
Yeah, I'm the news director for Voice for Men. I just want to give some background on Voice for Men for a while.
Yeah.
Voice for Men's been around for 5 years now. It was started by Paul Elam. It started basically as a personal blog of his. It has grown into something huge now. In the past several years, past 3 years, we've seen a lot of growth. We have a news department. We have a whole network of radio shows. We have news directors in Europe. We have news. We have a news director for Canada. We have a news director for the UK. We have a news director for Australia, as well as the US. And we tout ourselves now, and rightfully so, as the leaders in the men's rights movement. Of course, there are many other. I don't want to say leaders, but we want to say we call ourselves the flagship of the men's rights movement. We are identified more than any other single organization as a men's rights organization. But of course, there are many, many, many organizations. National Coalition for Men. There's lots of great websites out there for men's rights stuff out there. Anti-Misandry, you know, many others, more than I can name, really. Great YouTube channels as well. But we are basically a source for online news and commentary. Concerning men's rights and concerning men's issues. We engage in advocacy. We engage in activism. A lot of it's not very nice, but we do it anyway. We're going to have a conference coming up in June that's been announced on the website. So please, to your listeners, please come check us out. It's AVF. It's avoiceformen.com. Come check us out. A lot of neat things, a lot of great things are happening in the men's rights movement. We really think that there's some really great days ahead of us, and I hope that everyone checks us out and maybe thinks about engaging in activism with us.
All right. So, I definitely go to the website, and I'm definitely appreciating what I'm finding there. A lot of interesting articles.
Yeah, you'll see things there that you won't see anywhere else.
Oh yeah,
that's the cool thing about it. You won't see what's being written there anywhere else anywhere. Of course, but then again, I said before, there are lots of websites that you can turn to. We take submissions from people who have their own blogs, and we're kind of like the hub of a network of activists and advocates and people who write about this type of thing. So very proud to be part of it.
All right, I'm very happy to have you on.
Thanks for having me. Sure, thank you very much, Reginald. I hope to talk to you again sometime soon.
Oh yeah, well, definitely. All right.
All right, take care.
Take care.
All
right, bye-bye. All right, guys. Thanks for watching. Well, thanks for listening. And I hope you learned a lot here. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. Bye.